Hi, I'm Robin-Yann, and I organize the Tool Design Roundtables at GDC. This year we had three sessions of an hour each, where basically a whole bunch of people from the games industry and also outside of the games industry come together to talk about tool design. These are people from indie studios, AAA, but also sometimes Uber, TikTok, Amazon manufacturing. A bunch of people come together to talk about the tools that they're building, the UX of those tools, and people can put forward questions of like, hey, what do they want to have discussed? And people can then answer those questions as a group. We can then discuss about what we think and how we feel, what our experiences are. It's a really fun time. It's really, really great. And so this video is going over the particular highlights that I think are really great and useful of things that came out of the roundtables at GDC 2024 this year. So let's get into that. So yeah, Figma has won things we learned at the Tool Design Roundtables of GDC 2024. So this is a video of an article. If you would rather read instead of watch, please look below. This video just contains the highlights of it. You can find the full notes and read them through fully at the link below. So first, UX UI tool poll. So the one thing that always comes up is like, hey, what tools are people using nowadays? What are they using when they're building tools, doing UX for tools? What does that look like? So I always ask it when we start off the roundtables. And Figma has won. That's the main thing I learned from that poll this year is that Figma has entirely dominated the market. Like 98% of people were using Figma, just like the bulk majority of the room was using Figma. Everyone wanted to use Figma. They have absolutely won. Like they are the winners of everything else. Like Sketch, Adobe XD, Axure, Framer are used much, much less. We can tell. And also this has changed a lot over the years. Like it used to be that a lot more hands were differing between different tools, like a bunch of people Adobe XD, a bunch of people Axure, a bunch of people Framer, a bunch of people Sketch. But this year it was just like, no, Figma. Just everyone's using Figma. Only one person was using Adobe XD. Figma has won this out, which I think makes sense. Like the tooling that they have is really, really good, but it's like noticeable how much they've won the whole crowd in doing UX. Next, measuring success in tool UX. So someone asked like, hey, how do I measure correctly if I'm actually doing tool UX correctly? Like how do I know if I'm successful? Some folks use NPS, but nobody likes using it. Like NPS came up, of course, right away. I was just like, hey, you know, give it a number, use the NPS system. And some people are still using it, but everyone mentioned that they disliked using it. And I think it's the reason that, you know, are users happy? Are they saving time? Did quality go up? Are not really questions that are answered directly by NPS. Like NPS is very much a thing that gives you the initial idea of something's up. Like, are things going right or are things going wrong? But that's all it really does. Like it gives you an initial idea of what's happening, but not why it is happening, right? And so really digging into that was found by the group in the roundtable as a very important thing. But also, were you able to deliver the product on time and on quality? Because in the end, especially if you are in-house studio making tools that are, you know, releasing a product, releasing a game with those tools, and you're not releasing the tools themselves, in that case, the one thing that matters is the quality of the end product. If you're not publishing your tools, then the tool UX success measure here is like, is the project getting done on time and on the quality we need? That's really important, right? So that was the main thing about measuring tool UX, like the success of that. Try to look at like, are we actually delivering the thing that we need? So next is starting up a design system is tough. People ask like, hey, design system, what do we need to look out for when we're starting a design system? And getting funding to get us started at all was the main thing that a lot of people wrote up. Like, hey, it's really tough to just get the time to spend to actually set up a design system because it takes a lot of time. People really mentioned that, like it takes a bunch of time to do that initial setup, to get all the components working, doing all that work. It takes a lot of time. Getting that time out of the, you know, the limited amount of time that you always have in a project was seen as a very difficult thing by a lot of folks. And I mentioned that, like, please watch out for that. When you're starting up, setting a design system, watch out, that's gonna take a lot of time. You need to find that time. Second is upkeep once it exists is very tough. Like a bunch of people mentioned, like, you know, once we have it set up, people are like, great, but it can change it continually, right? Like a design system isn't done and set when you've made the initial version of it. There's always gonna be updates to it. Things are gonna change, you're gonna iterate. And iteration's good, right? Iteration's a great thing. But it takes time. So make sure that you actually have the time to do it. Like if you have a small team of UX designers, you might not have the time to like do that setup and do that kind of constant upkeep and iteration. If you have a bigger team, it might be easier, but you really have to look at, like, do we have the time to do that stuff? So, like, watch out for that when you're designing, when you're starting a design system. And also, design systems for games were constantly being made. Like, I asked folks, like, hey, who's making a design system for a game? And a whole bunch of people raised their hands. But then we asked, who's making a design system for their tools? And nobody raised their hands. Very spooky, because we could definitely realize, like, if our games are better because of the design systems that we're making, our tools would be too. Like, using the same components all over the place and reusing that is a good thing. So it was a bit surprising to see that. So, like, an important thing to think about is, like, make design systems for your tools as well. Next, getting feedback and getting empathy for users. Like, people are like, how do you get feedback? And also, how do you build empathy within the team for the users, like, for their plight? And the main thing that came up was office hours and open Slack channels. Like, have office hours, but, like, between this and this hour, you can come to me, tell me what's up, tell me about issues. And the other one was have open Slack channels where people can come in and complain about things, talk about things, show what they have problems with, those kinds of things. But there was mixed success. That open door policy that people were discussing, people were like, yeah, we did that, kind of worked here and there, not really great, we're still kind of dealing with the same issues. And then one person brought up, you should really be doing open door policy. Instead, try busting doors policy. So the busting doors policy is like, don't have office hours or open Slack channels. You can have them maybe as well. But the main thing they mentioned is like, bust into the meetings. Like, your users are having meetings talking about the work they're doing. Bust in there. Listen in. What are they saying? What are they having trouble with? And also, like, really go to people and find, like, hey, what are you struggling with? What is going on? I need to ask questions. Like, I want to know what you're doing. I want to sit behind you and see how you work. The bust in doors policy, which I really like. It's very much a thing of, like, a lot of people do not have the time or the energy or, you know, don't even want to, like, constantly reach out to folks. Come to them. Go to them. Like, hey, how can we help you? Much, much, much more important in this case. So I very much agree with, like, the bust in doors policy. Next, what makes a good warning dialogue? So people kept bringing up, like, destructive actions were being missed by users sometimes. Like, they would click through it, and then later would be going, like, oh, no, I deleted something. Something destructive happened. I didn't know. But even though, like, the dialogue says about it, you know, people don't read things, which is just how things are. Like, we cannot force people to read things. If you're in the flow of work, sometimes you just might miss something. So people brought up, how else could we do that? And of course, there was mixed success with red text, red buttons, warning icons, a shake of the window, those kinds of things, right? But again, very mixed success. A bunch of people were like, yeah, I tried this, not really working well. We could try it more, make it even redder, right? But at some point, it's going to look like a Christmas tree. That's not going to help anyone either. But then someone brought up, I think very well, instead try, don't be destructive. Hard drives are cheap. Which is very true. Like, that's hard drives are, like, if you can buy a couple more terabytes of SSD space quite cheaply nowadays. And if that take, like, if that saves hours and hours of work from someone, like, really expensive, like a senior or principal, what are you spending money on? Like, a little bit of hard drives? Like, go for it, right? Like, you can save those things that people are gonna have to be destructive with and do backups on those drives, like, save that content so they can get back to it later. It's a great point. Like, you see, it's also with, like, Houdini and Hammer, where they have, like, a special folder with backups, and you have, like, five different backups that are constantly being iterated on, so that if you do mess something up, if you destroy something accidentally, go and just, like, load up an earlier file, copy and paste it over again, you're going to have less trouble with it. This also brought us to a point where people kept mentioning, instead of trying to solve the problem, don't have the problem. Which sounds kind of like duh, but, like, it's really easy to forget that sometimes. Like, instead of constantly trying to solve problems, what is causing the problem? Can we prevent the problem from existing at all? It's a good point. It's tough sometimes to get out of that mood that you're working in and really consider what's going on here, but it's really important to do that, right? Next, hybrid work. How do you stay in touch with users? People were like, hey, there's a lot of hybrid work happening. How do we stay in touch with people? Because they're all over the place, you know, different time zones. They become sort of like names in a Slack instead of people that I'm really working with. People were mentioning that being an issue. And again, bust in doors policy. Bust on in. Who are you? How are you doing? What's up? How can I help you? Bust those doors in, right? And also, there was mixed success with, like, meetings and documentation. Like, if you set up more and more recurring meetings, release more and more documentation, most people don't read that, and most people get sick of meetings. You can get in touch with them that way, but it doesn't really work out well in the long term, is what a bunch of people in the room mentioned. Instead, try videos and GIFs. Like, people are like, hey, like, you just make a video, put it in Slack, people are going to watch it, like a small video, right? Or like a GIF of like, hey, we got a new feature, here's a GIF of the feature, here you go. People do really pay attention to that. Like, staying in touch with users in that way, where you give them something quick and easy to like just look at and understand, was seen as a thing that was like much better and worked better for a couple of folks. Next, how do you make your users accept new tools? Classic issue that every year always gets discussed at the tool design roundtables is, hey, we made a new tool, people aren't using it. Like, what do we do? Like, you know, folks prefer the old tool over the new tool, what do we do? And there's mixed success with like, yeah, like you just have to delete the old tool so they can only use the new one. Or you bribe them, you know, cookies, pizza, whatever works, right? Like, bribe them over to like get them like, hey, if you use this, come over here, come to this room, try out the tool, we'll give you cookies. And also, you know, talk to power users, like get the power users in first to make sure that, you know, they kind of like it and they can send it to other folks. That was also brought up. But again, people were like, it's kind of missed success. We tried that, has worked, hasn't worked. Instead, try making the new tool better than the old one. And I know, again, this is very much like those moments where you're like, like, yes, it's a little bit of a dumb moment, but it is the case where if you have an old tool with a bunch of features and you make a new tool that like looks better, but doesn't have all the features that people are using from the old tool, the new tool doesn't have that, people are still going to be using the old tool, right? You have to make sure that there's feature parity. You have to make sure that people really want to use it. Like, the best way to make people use a new tool is by making the new tool good enough that people really do want to use it. And I know that sounds kind of like, yeah, again, like duh, but like it is that simple. It is that the case of like, if the old thing has more features than the new thing, people are going to keep using the old thing. If you then delete or remove the new the old thing, people are also going to be upset at you, which is also not great, right? So like, you really have to take a look at like, how do I make that new tool so good that people want to use it? Next, how do you create a culture of design at your studio? So like, how do you make sure like more people care about design, more people are, you know, thinking about the design? So what came up there is that let folks see how users struggle. Like, sit them behind people, see how they struggle, and you will kind of go like, oh yeah, we need to improve this design. It needs to be better, right? Like, sit behind users, record videos of users, show those recordings to other people, kind of go like, see how users are struggling, see how they're having trouble. Super duper helpful, like, to kind of like make people kind of go like, oh yeah, this is important. And also, like, Steve Krug is still right. Like, above all else, do user tests. Like, always be user testing, right? Like, get people in, let them try things, sit behind them, record them, and that way you can really build this culture of design of everyone kind of go like, oh yeah, this needs to be better, this needs to be improved, I can see how people are struggling. Because everyone's struggled with software. Everyone's had issues with software somewhere along the way, and they've been frustrated. If they see it in someone else, they're gonna go like, oh yeah, I know what that feels like, let's see how we can improve this. So what topics would you want to see at a future roundtable? Like, let me know in the comments below. Like, I'm always looking for more stuff. Like, leave a comment for topics you'd want to discuss. There's also a link to the full roundtable notes below, so you can find that there. And I will also release the notes of the USD roundtable soon. So you can take a look at that, subscribe, you can take a look at that when it comes online. And that's it. Thank you very much. You can find me at Twitter, rystorm, and also Mastodon and Blue Sky nowadays. You can also find me on LinkedIn, and also, there's more tool UX design at my website, rystorm.com. And please, please join the toolsmiths.org. There's a Discord there. A whole bunch of tools people from all over the industry talk together about tools, about UI, about UX, about build systems, all the good stuff. So I hope to see you there. Thank you.